Welcome.
Thank you so much for the introduction. Thank you so much for sharing the image. That was the funnest day ever to go into the museum. Actually, that photo, which was part of a Yale story, Yale Daily News story, allowed us to visit the Peabody Museum amid its renovation. And so we were able to go in and, you know, as part of this photo shoot, essentially see the, you know, the guts of the museum. It was this incredible experience. So it was really, it brought back very fond memories to see that photo flashed up. I'm also really grateful to be part of this incredible local tradition in science communication that brings together scientists and the general public. I think it's outstanding. So thank you so much. I'm really, really honored to be here. So I'm going to share a little bit about my research, and we're going to talk about lizards today because I study lizards a lot. So let me open this up. Is everyone able to see? Just a thumbs up. Awesome. So we're getting some thumbs up. That's great. Okay, so I'm going to be talking about my science today. And so to sort of facilitate this conversation, I've tried to sort of pare down some of the jargon in the slides, but nonetheless, there may be moments where I say something that doesn't quite land. There may be a term that you don't understand, or there may be something about the slide that is unclear. If that's the case, I completely encourage you to, you know, use the raise your hand feature or to unmute yourself and just pause me and let me know that I've lost you. And please feel free to let me know that, and I will go back and try to explain whatever it is I was trying to explain. That being said, there are a few moments where I will request your participation, so be ready for that. It should be lots of fun. Okay, so today I'm going to be talking about my research on reptiles, and I'll be discussing in particular some of the work I've been doing on the role of behavior in evolution. But before we get there, we're going to start really big picture. Because at the broadest level, my research is motivated by a general observation in biology, which is that evolution proceeds unevenly. By this, I mean that some lineages and some traits diversify really, really rapidly, almost at warp speed. And yet there are others that seem to be inert or nearly so for millions of years. To explain what I mean, I'll give a few examples. In the case of lizards, their genitals, when compared to other aspects of their morphology, are evolving so much more quickly that they can be deemed to be evolving in, and I'm quoting directly from a press release headline here, at super speed. Equally impressive is that some aspects of the fish mandible can evolve up to 30 times faster than others. Now, keep in mind that these are all integrated structures that need to interact together, you know, for feeding, etc. And yet some features can evolve an order of magnitude faster than others. I find this fascinating. So what I'm really saying is that evolution operates at different speeds. Sometimes evolution drives along the autobahn. Sometimes it goes in overdrive, even evolving really, really quickly. And in other cases, evolution can be much more like driving on I-95 in Brantford, or even in downtown New York City or New Haven at rush hour. It's very, very slow and seems sometimes to even grind to a halt. Why is this? Why does evolution sometimes zip along extremely quickly? And in other cases, why is it stuck in evolution's slow lane? Well, I approach this question by studying one of evolution's key architects, which is behavior. Through their behavior, organisms can exploit new resources, enter new environments, in turn exposing them to selection and accelerating evolution. And in other cases, organisms can preferentially choose areas in the habitat that match their ancestral preferences, and in so doing, shield themselves from natural selection and pump the brakes on the whole process. Now I'll break down what that means and give a few examples. My research really centers around unpacking the myriad ways that organisms behaviorally interact with their physical environments and determining how those interactions structure evolutionary patterns of diversity. To give an example, consider this tropical lizard perched on a tree. In order to gather resources, grow, survive, and reproduce. It interacts with its environment through several features. For example, its ability to sprint is limited by the thermal dependence of its performance, its hydric and metabolic economy, and its morphological dimensions, as well as its behavioral preferences. And all of these features, in turn, interact in really complex ways. So my work centers around unpacking and dissecting all of the complex ways organisms interact with their environments and what that means for their evolution. And in particular, I like to focus on one key variable of great importance for lizards, but also more generally for all ectothermic organisms, which is the thermal dependence of performance, and therefore temperature being an extremely important variable for ectotherms like lizards, but actually most animals, except for birds and mammals, and a few other exceptions, are also ectotherms. In ectotherms like lizards, the ability to perform a task such as sprinting is contingent on body temperature such that it's optimized over a relatively narrow range of temperatures and then decreases at higher and lower temperatures until the animal is immobilized. Now imagine, I mean, it takes a second to sort of think about this, but imagine going for a run in the desert. We may sweat a lot more, we may be really uncomfortable, but our body temperature pretty much stays the same. And we're able to keep running whether it's hot or whether it's cold. Imagine being a lizard by contrast, and if the temperature goes above that limit, locomotion ceases. Now the critical thermal limits for locomotion are not tantamount to the lethal limits. So you have an animal that is quite literally immobilized. That is how dramatic the thermal dependence of performance is. Now this curve has a lot of really important features. There are critical thermal limits, the critical thermal minimum and the critical thermal maximum, temperatures above and below which locomotion ceases. This curve has a maximum performance. It also has a temperature at which performance is optimized. There's a thermal range across which performance is optimal or nearly so. My research centers around dissecting this curve into its component features and discovering the variables that sculpt their evolution. And I do so in a lot of reptile and amphibian lineages, but today I'm going to be focusing perhaps on my preferred and most favorite lineage of reptiles, which are anoleless lizards. Anoles are an extremely diverse radiation of lizards distributed throughout the tropical and subtropical regions of the Western Hemisphere. There's more than 400 species total in this radiation, and they are particularly diverse in the Caribbean, where more than 150 species can be found. And you may know this lineage because the Caribbean anoles are a poster child or classic example of adaptive radiation, of a very rapid and prolific burst of evolution, followed by diversification into many distinct structural niches. So on each of the major islands of the Greater Antilles, this being Cuba, Jamaica, Puerto Rico, and Hispaniola, independently, these diverse assemblages of lizard microhabitat specialists called ecomorphs have independently arisen. And it's quite remarkable. For example, those two crown giant anoles from Hispaniola and Puerto Rico, they look very, very similar. They perch at the very top of the canopy, and yet they are not closely related at all. These forms independently arose. So this system is very much like Darwin's finches, a very classic system in ecology and evolution, and a lot of research has centered around unpacking the mechanisms underlying their incredible species diversity, as well as their morphological adaptations to all of these different structural niches. And of course, anoles are also just these beautiful jewel-toned, hyper-charismatic organisms to work with. They have these extensible throat fans termed dewlaps, which they use in social communication and in territorial defense. And they're just, you know, extremely fun, really charismatic organisms to work with. But today, I'm going to be focusing on my preferred type of anole, the LBL, the little brown lizard. And what this lineage, the cybotoids, the lineage comprised of Anolis cybotes, shown here, and its close relatives from the Caribbean island of Hispaniola. And what this lineage lacks in blues and oranges and greens, I promise you it makes up for in physiological badassery. So Today I'll be trying to address two major questions, because of course we're going to talk about the role of behavior in evolution, and because I've hinted that temperature matters a lot, the specific behavior I'll be focusing on is thermoregulation. And what I'd like to talk about today is how thermoregulatory behavior can be a break for evolution. That's where we'll start. Then we'll talk about whether thermoregulatory behavior can actually be a motor for evolution. And then hopefully at the end, maybe we can revisit some classic ideas about the role of behavior in evolution with some fresh perspectives. Okay, so I focused on Hispaniola as an island for a couple of reasons. Perhaps the most salient for this story is that it's very topographically complex. You can go 3,000 meters above sea level and still be on a Caribbean island, but only if you do so on Hispaniola. And Hispaniola, as a reminder, is the island comprised of Haiti in the west and the Dominican Republic in the east. The island itself is dissected into two major mountain chains, the Cordillera Central in the eastern side of the island and the Sierra de Bauruco in the western half of the island. And down near sea level, both for lizards and for Homo sapiens, it is a very warm, lush, tropical, balmy, pleasant island. Exactly what you would expect of the Caribbean. If you've been to Puerto Rico or other islands in the area, it's all quite similar. But as you go up in elevation in Hispaniola, and I mean really up in elevation, the habitat seeds from this tropical forest into this relative moonscape of monodominant pine forests surrounded by bunchgrass fields and rocky outcrops. And it's cold up there. Due to this topographic complexity, there are places on Hispaniola where it can be 20 degrees Celsius colder than near sea level. That's very dramatic variation, particularly in a tropical environment, and particularly from the perspective of the tropical organisms that populate that island. It's not uncommon, even in the summer, to see frost at high elevation, which I quickly discovered during my first expedition to the Dominican Republic for research, for which I was quite frankly woefully underprepared. But I had excellent company on the summits of this island in the form of anolis lizards. In the western mountains at the highest elevations, you can see anolis armori, and in the eastern mountains, you can see anolis shrevi. And just their presence there is an anomaly. These are the highest elevations in the Caribbean where anoles can be found. It's only true in Hispaniola. And these two species, Anolis armori and Anolis shrevi, are together part of a broader radiation of Anolis lizards, again, these cybatoid anoles. Now, some members of this lineage or clade, as we call them, are restricted to low elevation, found essentially only near sea level. A couple of members of this lineage creep up into mid elevation, maybe 900, 1000 meters. One species, Anolis cybodes, is remarkable. This species is effectively found island-wide, except at the highest elevations of the island, where it becomes replaced by Anolis armori in the western mountains and Anolis shrevi in the eastern mountains. Now, keep in mind that anoles are ancestrally tropical lizards, so my first forays into this system were really purely curiosity-based. I really wanted to know how, if at all, were these tropical lizards behaviorally or physiologically compensating for these incredibly cold environments. And to start, along with an incredible team of undergraduate researchers, we scoured the island for as many populations of these anoles as we could get our hands on, and we started by focusing on two really important physiological traits: the critical thermal minimum, that is cold tolerance, this is the lower limit of locomotion, and the critical thermal maximum, or heat tolerance, the upper limit of locomotion. And the way that we measure this is either by systematically cooling or heating lizards by about a degree per minute, and then beginning to flip the lizard onto their back and determine the temperature at which they lose the ability to right themselves, this being the limit of locomotion. And as you can see, it involves incredibly sophisticated equipment in the form of a Tupperware container and a heat lamp. So it's a very field-friendly protocol. Okay, so I'm going to start with the data, and I'm going to start with cold tolerance first. On this plot, elevation is on the x-axis from sea level to about 2.5 kilometers above sea level, and CT min, or cold tolerance, is on the y-axis. Each point is going to correspond to a population mean, and the color of those points will tell you the species from which the data were gathered. Now, as a reminder, cold tolerance, a lower value of cold tolerance indicates a more cold tolerant population. They were able to tolerate a lower temperature before losing their locomotor ability. And here's what we found. Effectively, an extremely strong clinal relationship between elevation and cold tolerance, such that those high elevation anoles were up to 7 degrees Celsius more cold tolerant than their low elevation counterparts. For very closely related species of lizards, this is a lot of cold tolerance variation. This is pretty dramatic. Let's do the same exercise, but now with heat tolerance. Again, elevation's on the x-axis. Now heat tolerance is on the y-axis. A higher CT max corresponds to a more heat tolerant population. And here's what we found. About half as much within population variation for heat tolerance as cold tolerance, and absolutely no relationship whatsoever between heat tolerance and elevation. Whether at sea level or 2,500 meters above sea level, heat tolerance hovers somewhere between 38 and 40 degrees Celsius. This was a little bit surprising given just how different these environments are. So it encouraged us to maybe take a deeper perspective of the thermal environment as perceived by those lizards in these different environments. So what we did was visit four sites near, 45 meters, 700 meters, 1600, and just under 2,500 meters. And at each of those sites, we deployed a series of thermal sensors across the habitat to basically get a perspective of what the thermal environment looks like, you know, at night and during the day. And I'm gonna start with the nighttime temperatures first. So on this plot, time is on the x-axis going from sundown to sun up, and temperatures on the y-axis. And color will tell you the different sites from which the temperatures were gathered. And here's what we found. Basically, thermal variation is very compressed at night. Within any given site, there's only about 5 to 10 degrees Celsius thermal variation. And importantly, very little, if any, of that thermal variation is shared across sites. And obviously, it gets progressively cooler with altitude. Correspondingly, you can envision the nighttime environment on Hispaniola to look something like this. There's a lot of thermal structuring across elevation, and there's very little variation within any given site. Correspondingly, this structuring of cold tolerance with elevation makes intuitive sense. The pattern in the physiological trait really seems to follow the pattern of what's available temperature-wise in the thermal environment. It all makes sense. Let's do the same exercise, but now with the daytime temperatures. Again, time is on the x-axis. Now we're going from sun up to sundown. These are the same four sites. Here are the daytime temperatures. A lot of thermal variation, up to 40 degrees Celsius thermal variation at any given site. And there's a lot of shared thermal variation. These sites overlap dramatically in the thermal conditions available to lizards. Maybe it doesn't get quite so warm at high elevation or quite so cool at low elevation, but overall you can see that there's a solid block of shared thermal conditions across elevation during the day. At correspondingly, you can envision the thermal environment during the day to look something like this. A lot of heterogeneity and a lot of shared heterogeneity across elevation. Now, if heat tolerance varied in a way that mirrored the patterns we observed for cold tolerance, based on this, we would have expected a lot of within population variation and some sort of clinal relationship with elevation, maybe a shallower one, but some relationship. But that's not what we observed at all. In fact, the data looked a lot more like this. Very little within population variation, no relationship whatsoever with elevation. So what gives? It turns out that there was a piece missing from this equation, and it encouraged, this is good. When things are unexpected, it encourages you to go back to square one and to rethink the whole scenario. And what we discovered was that we were missing a crucial piece. And to get there, maybe someone, a brave soul, would feel comfortable unmuting themselves and sharing an observation about something unusual that you can see this Anolis cybotes lizard doing. And I promise you, there are no wrong answers. I've heard all of them.
Was one leg up?
Yeah, it's lifting its foot up.
Exactly. Yes, do you see how it's elevating its hind limb off the surface of the leaf? And in fact, if you look in closely, you can even see that it's curling its foretoes off the surface of the leaf as well. It's basically, it's perched on this really hot exposed leaf. It's using its behavior to modify its thermal environment, to limit its surface contact with that very hot leaf. And it turns out that behavior was the missing piece of this equation. But before I get there, I'm gonna start talking about behavioral thermoregulation. And you probably have heard of this idea. In the simplest sense, when you put on a jacket, you're in some sense behaviorally thermoregulating, right? Or when you go in when it's too hot or too cold. And it can seem intuitive or maybe even obvious as a concept, but I guarantee you that it's not. It's actually only been formalized scientifically for less than a century, in the 1940s, in fact. To put this into context, we as a community discovered the structure of DNA barely a decade after the idea of thermoregulation was formalized. So it's worth taking a step back and explaining what it is we mean by behavioral thermoregulation. And in order to do that, let's take a bird's eye view of a thermal habitat. Maybe deep in the forest, it's too cold for the lizards. Maybe out in the open, they'll fry, it's too hot. Maybe it's just the flanking vegetation along the periphery of the forest that is Goldilocks optimal for those lizards. Because I'm a big New York Mets fan, let's go ahead and color those thermally optimal patches some blue and orange in honor of the Mets. And let's assume that a lizard were to randomly shuttle between all of the available thermal patches in its habitat. Such a thermal conforming lizard would indeed experience the highs, the lows, the in-betweens. In short, all of that thermal heterogeneity that's available to it. But if instead a lizard were simply to preferentially shuttle between those thermally optimal patches, it would actually only experience a relatively narrow subset of the available thermal environment. In so doing, from the lizard's perspective, the environment may in fact look something more like this. And that's exactly what these cybatoid anoles from Hispaniola are doing. What I'm showing you here now are body temperature data that I gathered from the same exact populations from which I gathered heat and cold tolerance data. And what you can see is that across 2.5 kilometers of elevation, field measured body temperatures only drop by about 1.5 degrees. To put that into context, if these same lizards had been passive with respect to the thermal environment, those temperatures should have dropped by more than 10 degrees Celsius. So they're clearly doing something behaviorally to buffer or mitigate this incredible variation in the thermal environment. And to visualize the same pattern differently, what I'm saying is that in the absence of thermal regulation, the environment is just as variable as it is, like in the situation on the left. But through their thermoregulatory behavior, these lizards effectively homogenize all of that variation and actually transform it into an environment that looks something more on the right, much more thermally homogeneous, a lot of similarity between high and low elevation. In fact, no discernible differences. The body temperatures, I'm sorry, I'm getting on a side here. But if you were to give me a body temperature from one of these anoles, I would be incapable of telling you the elevation from which they were gathered. That's how precise their thermal regulation can be. But we can take this one step further still. Now, back in the 1940s, when this idea was originally formulated, one of the architects of this idea, Charles Bogert, shown here, gave it a bit more thought in a follow-up paper in 1949. And he said, wait a minute. By behaviorally buffering themselves from environmental variation, they're not just limiting exposure to temperatures, they're actually modifying natural selection. They are editing their selective environments. And he proposed that lineages that could behaviorally buffer themselves from thermal variation should exhibit less physiological variation. And when translated over long evolutionary time periods, this may result in a slower overall rate of evolution. This is an inherently evolutionary hypothesis that behavior can limit exposure to selection and slow the rate of evolution down. And that's exactly what's occurring in these lizards. As we saw, those nighttime temperatures are extremely homogeneous and they get progressively cooler with elevation. In effect, there's no thermal escape from the cold. By contrast, these diurnal lizards spend their days running around their habitats. Those habitats are quite variable. This gives them the nimbleness with which to behaviorally buffer themselves against daytime temperatures, either to cool off with respect to lower elevations or to warm up at higher elevations. When translated over long evolutionary time periods, this has resulted in different rates of evolution. Not only is cold tolerance faster evolving, it's up to an order of magnitude faster evolving than body temperature, preferred temperatures, and heat tolerance. This is that behavioral inertia or Bogert effect in action. In fact, the original term for this is behavioral inertia, behavior serving as an inertial force in evolution. But in honor of Charles Bogert, we also know this as the Bogert effect because of his pioneering influence on these ideas. Now, something that I found a little bit unsatisfying about this work was, you know, you go up to high elevation and you see these lizards thermoregulating and you wonder, why the heck are you even bothering? Why not just adjust your physiology to the environment that you occupy? And one possibility is that heat tolerance is evolutionarily inert for reasons completely unrelated to behavior. So what I did was gather every datum I could get my hands on for heat tolerance in reptiles, and I was able to get more than 268 independent measurements. And what I discovered was that there's more than 25 degrees Celsius variation. That's substantial. That's a lot of variation. And if we zoom in just on anolis lizards, we recover more than 20 degrees Celsius variation. So it's certainly not the case that CT max and or heat tolerance can't evolve. It certainly does. Instead, what I think is happening is that these montane lizards are behaviorally capitalizing on the physiological benefits of a higher core temperature. In general, when organisms perform a task at a higher core temperature, up until a certain limit, they are able to do so at a higher maximal performance. By this, I mean that if you are warm adapted, you may also be a faster runner, put differently. So what I think is happening is that these montane anoles, rather than adjust their physiology to the cold environments, are capitalizing on the benefits of maintaining a relatively high core temperature. Okay. So far, I've really focused on the role of behavior as a potential inertial force in evolution. It allows organisms to, you know, maintain similar body temperatures, for example, across a really wide elevational gradient, and in so doing, limit the rate of physiological evolution, particularly in traits like heat tolerance. But this is just one perspective on the role of behavior in evolution. And if anything, I don't even think it's the more widely embraced or classical perspective. If anything, the classical view of the role of behavior in evolution is that it should drive evolution. And one of the chief proponents of this idea is Ernst Mayr. He's a former curator and museum director for the Museum of Comparative Zoology at Harvard, and he was an incredibly influential force in the evolutionary biology community for, you know, decades and decades. So he spent a lot of time studying the biodiversity of birds, and he spent many, many years traveling throughout the tropical regions of the world trying to understand what has led to the incredible biodiversity of birds. This diversity, he posited, was in no small part due to behavior. Behavior, he argued, allows organisms to exploit new resources in their environments or to enter new environments altogether. And in so doing, this should expose organisms to new selective pressures, in turn driving evolution or accelerating it. Now, I don't want to say that behavioral drive and behavioral inertia are mutually exclusive concepts. They certainly aren't. But they've been largely studied independently. And if I can maybe oversimplify, I would say that comparative physiologists have long studied behavioral inertia or the Bogert effect, and comparative morphologists have long studied behavioral drive. And this is a little bit, you know, too black and white. There's certainly lots of shades of gray, but overall, that's been a lot of how the literature has proceeded. But I think these ideas may in fact be somewhat linked. And the reason is that any resource an organism behaviorally capitalizes on may influence selection in multiple trait dimensions. So these high elevation anoles, however they're thermoregulating, may involve some shift in resource use that may be shielding them from selection on physiology, but it may also be exposing them to selection in some other aspect of the phenotype, some other trait. This was the hypothesis that we wanted to test, to see if there are any correlated effects of behavior on other aspects of the phenotype. And in order to do that, we really needed to mechanistically pinpoint how the hell, to put it frankly, these high elevation lizards were so successfully thermoregulating in really, really cold environments. So what I did was visit both low and high elevation sites on Hispaniola. The two low elevation sites were both in the foothills of the Sierra de Bauruco and the Cordillera Central, respectively, with some images shown here. And the high elevation sites, again, are these very, very cold environments, monodominant pine forests surrounded by bunch grass fields and rocky outcrops, really different environments, one site each in the Western Mountains and the Eastern Mountains. Now, in order to understand whether and how organisms are thermoregulating, we actually need three pieces of data, and I'm going to walk you through those pieces of data. First, we need some understanding of the thermal environment from the perspective of the lizard. What are the temperatures they could theoretically access? How cold could they get? How warm could they get? What would the average temperature be in the absence of behavior? That's the kind of information we need. And in order to gather that information, we went into the craft store where every good biologist spends some time, and we built these electroformed copper lizard models. This is literally copper electroformed in the shape of an anoleless lizard. And the reason we use electroformed copper is that it has a similar thermal inertia to live lizards, meaning it heats up and it cools off at a comparable rate. And embedded inside of each of these copper lizard models is a little sensor that is recording temperature every 10 minutes. And we set these devices out in the habitat to record temperatures every 10 minutes over the course of a week at each of these sites. And because these lizards are trunk ground anoles, that is the ecological category to which they belong, we deployed these models in roughly equal numbers on boulders and on tree trunks because these are the perches that these lizards most commonly utilize. At the same time that those devices were out in the environment measuring temperatures, we were out in the habitats as well, collecting live lizards and actually measuring their field measured body temperature. So what are the lizards actually doing in the habitat? And of course, this is the most fun part of the project. So here on the left, you can see my former undergraduate, Ellie Cook, looking for Anola shrevi up at high elevation. Here I am on the right with my former undergraduate, Tony, taking a temperature from a lizard back when I thought bangs would work for me. And then in order to understand how precisely lizards are thermoregulating, you need to understand what thermal range they're theoretically targeting. Like what's the range that they would hope to achieve? And in order to know that, we actually have to bring a subset of lizards back to the lab. And what we did was expose them to a thermal gradient that ranged from 18 degrees on one end to 40 degrees on the other, and just allowed them to choose where to sit over the course of 4 hours and measure temperatures during that experiment. And the reason that this is helpful is that there's no food, there's no predators, there's no competitors. The only thing that matters is temperatures. So basically these temperatures allow us to understand, you know, and calibrate, you know, what are they targeting in the field? And this lets us know whether they're precise or sloppy at achieving those temperatures. Okay, I'm gonna show you the results, but before I do, I wanted to actually build some sham or dummy data to sort of prime you so that you know what to expect. What I've given here is a null distribution of potential environmental temperatures, operative temperatures, basically the range of temperatures that these lizards could theoretically achieve in the field. If the range and mean of those temperatures really overlap with what's available in the environment, we infer that that population of lizards are thermal conformers. If by contrast, the mean and range of observed body temperatures is quite different from what's available in the habitat, we instead infer that those lizards are thermoregulators. And of course we have metrics that we can apply to this to put numbers behind the visual patterns. Okay, so now I'm gonna walk you through the results and I'm gonna start with low elevation first. The Western Mountains are on the left side and the Eastern Mountains are on the right side. These are histograms. And so I'm just showing you the temperatures that we measured. Here are the temperatures we measured on boulders at low elevation. Here are the temperatures we measured on tree trunks at low elevation. Here are the lizard body temperatures. Ooh, I need another brave soul. Thermal conformers or thermal regulators at low elevation?
Conformers.
Conformers.
Totally, totally conformers. In fact, I was very surprised when I initially saw this. They're really passive at low elevation with respect to temperature. And it turns out when we superimpose the preferred range as measured in the laboratory heat gradient, we now better understand why. And the reason is they live in kind of a Goldilocks environment that's already kind of optimally warm. It turns out that, you know, vacationing in the Caribbean is pleasant, not just for humans, but also for lizards. At low elevation, they really don't have to be very behaviorally precise. They can be quite passive, quite lazy with respect to their thermal environments, and still achieve temperatures within their preferred range a lot of the time. So put differently, they don't thermoregulate actively because they kind of don't have to. Let's do the same exercise at high elevation. Here are the temperatures I measured on boulders. Here are the temperatures I measured on tree trunks. First, super scientific conclusion. I promise you, this is a highly scientific finding. Trees are colder than boulders. Here are the lizard body temperatures. Thermoconformers or thermoregulators?
They're still conformers.
Regulating.
Definitely regulators, extremely strong regulators, in fact, when we superimpose, and it could also, I totally understand why you might think thermoconformers, because they still have temperatures that are available in the environment. So to an extent, that's correct, but they're actually quite precise behavioral thermoregulators because the temperatures that they're targeting are super rare in their environments. They're targeting extremely uncommon temperatures. And when you superimpose their preferred range on this plot, that's what the dashed lines are showing, you can see that they're also incredibly precise thermoregulators. Nearly 100% of the time, they've managed to achieve temperatures in a thermal range that's exceedingly rare in their habitat. When we zoom in on this narrow little sliver of the environment that's actually optimally warm for thermoregulation, this finding that trees are cold suddenly becomes highly relevant. And the reason is that more than 95% of the temperatures that I measured on tree trunks were simply too cold for lizards. They could not effectively thermoregulate. Instead, boulders were 5 to 6 times more likely to fall within lizards' preferred thermal range. So to put this differently, an enterprising lizard at high elevation could quite effectively thermoregulate simply by eschewing tree trunks and opting instead to perch on boulders. And that's exactly what these lizards do. At low elevation, they exhibit the arboreal niche that is typical of anolis lizards. And at high elevation, they've almost completely switched over to become boulder dwelling or saxicolous. Why does this matter? Well, it matters because the entire theory of the anolis adaptive radiation is predicated on the incredibly intimate connection between structural microhabitat use, that is, where precisely in the environment these organisms perch, and their corresponding morphological specializations. So put differently, when a lizard changes where in the habitat it perches, it's a pretty good inference that morphological evolution might follow. So our next logical step was simply to measure a few morphological traits that tend to evolve when reptile lineages go boulder dwelling from arboreal ancestors. And these often boil down to skull and limb dimensions. So what we did was gather adult lizards from high and low elevation and measure their morphological traits. And I'm going to start with skull height. This is basically telling you how tall the skull is, relatively speaking. And what we found was that in both the western and the eastern mountains, those high elevation anoles have dorsal ventrally compressed skulls. They're flatter. And sometimes you don't even need to do the math, because the common name for the low elevation population is known as the large-headed anole. They have very chonky heads. But you can do the math, and when you do, you discover an extremely strong signal of dorsoventral compression in those high elevation lizards. Now, because we caught lizards from the wild, one possibility is that this difference in morphology relates to them growing up in different environments. So we took this one step further. We brought high and low elevation anoles into the lab. We allowed them to lay eggs, and then we reared their young under common laboratory conditions, and then re-measured those traits when those lizards became adults, and discovered that the differences persisted. Whether measured from wild populations or through laboratory reared populations, those high elevation lizards have dorsoventrally compressed skulls. Now, the adaptive value of this is quite intuitive. These lizards don't just perch on boulders for warmth. They defend them as territories. They retreat under them when threatened, and they sleep under them at night. They have, in the truest sense, become boulder-dwelling or saxicolous lizards, and having a flattened body shape eases access into the crevices that they now occupy. We also detected tandem reductions in hind limb length, and those differences persisted in the laboratory rear generation. Now, hind limb length is a slightly more complex trait, but in general, greater limb parity, this meaning greater similarity in fore and hind limb dimensions, is a feature generally associated with greater stability during climbing, and these high elevation anoles effectively spend their lives scrabbling across cliff faces and boulders. So what am I really trying to say? Well, what I'm trying to say is not only our behavioral drive, effectively what we've seen here is behavioral drive. There was a shift in resource use at high elevation to go from perching on trees to perching on boulders. That perch switch certainly shielded organisms from selection on physiology through the thermoregulatory benefits afforded by those boulders, but it also, as a correlated effect, induced evolution in morphology. And the reason for this is actually quite intuitive. Any resource that an organism uses doesn't just matter for one aspect of the phenotype, right? A rock wasn't just a physiological resource, it was also a morphological resource, right? And so the behavioral decision, and more importantly, the behavioral decisions that organisms make do not occur in selective vacuums. Put differently, when this lizard has made the behavioral decision to perch on this very hot leaf, it hasn't just made a behavioral decision about its thermal environment, it's actually made a whole slew of decisions. It's made a decision about its radiative environment, its hydric environment. It's made a biomechanical decision. That substrate it's perching on has a certain height, frictive coefficient, and surface area. It's likewise made a decision about the predators, competitors, and parasites that it might encounter. So really, putting all the pieces together, any behavioral decision an organism can make can have multiple and potentially contrasting evolutionary signatures on different traits. So not only is there behavioral drive and behavioral inertia, but these may actually be fundamentally linked phenomena. And that's really these are the vignettes I wanted to talk about today. And with that, I just wanted to thank you for your time and leave plenty of time for questions and just discussion as well. Thank you.
Thank you. I have a quick question. Thanks, Hussein. Thanks for coming by. I have a quick question. So how many generations in the lab would you need to actually see a phenotypic change?
So that's a very good question. So if we were interested in inducing evolution in the lab, like creating a phenotypic shift, then we would need minimally one generation, because evolution is an intergenerational phenomenon. We may need more depending on the heritability of the trait and the strength of selection that we're inducing. In the case of these lizards, we weren't trying to induce a phenotypic shift. We were trying to see whether the environment itself was completely responsible for the morphological differences. For example, how else to put it? There are some phenotypic plasticity describes the ability for one genotype, the same genetic composition, to result in different phenotypes. So for example, if you grow a plant in low light versus high light, how much it leafs will differ, even though the genetics are exactly the same. So what we were interested in knowing is, are those high elevation anoles dorsoventrally compressed because they've grown up in a rocky environment? Or is it something that's basically hardwired into their DNA? Is this a heritable shift between low and high elevation? Is this an evolved difference? And because those lizards, so what we did, we took low elevation lizards and high elevation lizards, we bred them only with each other. We didn't combine them with each other. And we got the eggs, and then we reared the eggs and the young under exactly the same conditions, 29 degrees Celsius, constant thermal conditions, same access to food, same access to perches, and then re-measured those traits when they reached adulthood. If those differences had compressed, meaning we no longer detected any differences, for example, in skull height, that would have told us that really the phenotypic differences we observed in the field were purely environmentally driven with no perceivable heritable basis.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yeah. Yes.
Were there any nutritional changes when going from tree to rock? And were there any behavioral changes on what it preyed?
So the short answer is we don't have very good data on this. We just luckily got some funding to go back to the Caribbean and do a more detailed study of diet, but I can give you some general feedback to that question. Anoles are generalist insectivores. You ever hear about cats, if I fits, I sits, like that thing? Have you ever heard that about cats?
Yeah.
Anoles are like, if it fits, I eat. And so they're really just gape limited insectivores. So unlike snakes, which for example, are not gape limited because they can unhinge their jaws. Basically anoles will eat any insect that, and they're sit and wait predators. So they basically just hang out on their perches and wait for insects to come to them. There may be some differences in the insects that occupy, you know, more closed environments at low elevation where these lizards are found versus the more open rocky environments at higher elevation. It's entirely possible, but we don't know of any precisely because we haven't looked for them. But I think you're sort of hinting at a broader question, which is there anything else that may be varying with respect to this altitudinal shift and this behavioral shift? And the answer would be yes to that question. And one of the other features we did examine is wariness or escape behavior. In particular, those high elevation, we have this metric called flight initiation distance, which tells you how close can you get to a lizard if you walk straight in its direction before it starts to flee. And the bigger that flight initiation distance, the flightier or warier those lizards are. Now, this you could see the intuitive likelihood here. Those high elevation anoles are by design perching in super open environments, plenty of avian predators up there. Seems like a very exposed place to be. And indeed, those lizards are super, super flighty. You can barely get within 2 meters of them and they immediately flee, and they flee a greater distance. At low elevation, by contrast, you can almost walk up to them and you practically have to slap your hand on the tree for them to be bothered to like move and try to escape from you. And if they do, they're quite lazy and they barely just walk around to the other side of the tree trunk. So diet could be shifting, although I don't know if it is. Again, these are generalist insectivores, but surely there are other dimensions that are responding to this behavioral switch to boulders, flight initiation distance being one of them.
I have another question, and perhaps you mentioned this and I missed it, but I know you talked about the head shape that does not change when you breed these in the lab, but what if you have you taken the lizards which are at a particular elevation and moved them to another elevation and seen what sort of behavioral changes occur with generations, or would they just escape back to their original place?
So you've described my dream experiment, which is a reciprocal transplant in which I take low elevation anoles to high elevation, figure out whether they behaviorally know what to do. In other words, I think you're asking, is the behavior itself labile, or are there heritable differences in behavior that contribute to this? The short answer is we don't know. The slightly longer answer is that I think it's labile, and I'll explain what I mean. So I wanted to do precisely that, but the high elevation anoles are technically described as a different species than the low elevation ones. So in order to do that, the Dominican government would have had to be okay with actually transplanting different species into habitats they're not known to occupy. And that was not considered a favorable experiment to run. I think they were concerned with these lizards getting out and dispersing and you know, altering. So I wanted to do that, but it wasn't feasible. And that makes total sense. However, I did look at relative boulder use across elevation. So I showed you the ends of the distribution, right? Okay. I focused on low elevation and high elevation, but I also did field work across the entire climb. And what I found is that the relative use of boulders progressively increases with elevation. It's not an abrupt transition. There isn't some logistic shift in, you know, using all trees and then using all boulders. So it seems to me that as the environment gets progressively cooler, they get progressively more, their preference for boulders progressively increases, which suggests to me that there's probably some lability in local adjustment. There was a really good study that did exactly what I wanted to do, but they did it with a different lineage of lizards. They worked with Phrynosoma. This is the species they worked with, I believe, was in Arizona. And what they did was take Phrynosoma from low elevation and transport it to high elevation, and Phrynosoma from high elevation and transport them to low elevation, and basically look at what behaviors they do. And basically, they knew exactly what to do. They immediately transitioned into the behavioral types that you would expect based on the elevation. So that at least in that species, it seemed to be quite labile and flexible within an organism's lifetime to adjust, you know, what sun and shade you use, for example, to properly thermoregulate in the elevation, you know, in the environment in which you're found. All this to say, I don't know for sure in these lizards, but I suspect that it's labile.
I actually have a related question. Has anybody looked at the protein expression profile of the difference between these low elevation and high elevation lizards? I know you just said that they're considered different species, mm-hmm. but what about the gradation, the intermediate?
So the protein, no. And that lineage has not really been studied in that regard. There is work on other species of anoles looking at gene expression differences in response to thermal stress. And I can think of one really cool study that came out just last year. Kristen Winchell and Shane Campbell-Staten were the primary authors on that. And it was examining the heat island or the urban heat island effect in Anolis cristatellus from Puerto Rico. This is a nearby island, another species of anole. And basically they looked at basically which genes are expressed in response to heat stress in urban populations, which you might assume, you know, are exposed to greater heat stress, they being, you know, in this urban heat island, and nearby populations in more natural, canopied, forested, i.e. cooler environments. And I don't remember the details with incredible precision, but in essence, yeah, there were actually quite dramatic expression differences between those urban anoles and their nearby forested counterparts. In fact, if I recall correctly, the expression profiles were more similar among geographically separated but urbanized population of anoles than to their geographic, more proximate but natural forested counterparts.
That's fascinating.
Yeah, it's really cool research.
We had a speaker some many years ago who had actually talked about thermoregulation in humans. And I was thinking about that when I asked about the expression patterns.
Yeah, and it's a totally different ball game with homeotherms, like mammals and birds. Yeah, my expertise is definitely in the ectothermic lineages.
Would anyone, I've kind of hogged the questioning, would anyone like to ask?
Hi, Steve, I see a hand raised.
Yeah, how have they handled sudden drastic environmental change, like even the asteroid strike 66 million years ago, or ice ages, or even the present day problem with climate change?
Those are a lot of different stressor events. The first one is the easiest. These Hispaniolan anoles did not exist when the meteor struck 66 million years ago. This is a younger radiation of anoles, a couple million years old. And anoles lizards in general are, you know, in the order, some people say around 50 million years old would be the crown age of the clade. The age varies depending on one's preferred phylogenetic hypothesis and the fossil calibrations used. But these anoles are definitely younger than that. Ice ages, in general, the prevailing theory is that organisms track their preferred climates to refugia during different climatic episodes. So, for example, if it becomes very, very cold, the elevation at which you observe lizards will be lower. If it becomes very, very warm, the elevation will move up. And this actually tracks the habitat. On Hispaniola, for example, using fossil pollen, folks have found that during a relatively warmer period, about 5,500 years ago, cloud forests used to be found in the environments where I did my study that is now monodominant pine forest. There's no cloud forest. So the cloud forest ends several hundred meters below that. And when it was warmer, it used to be cloud forest up there. And if there was cloud forest, then you can imagine that the lizards you today see in cloud forest would be distributed much higher up than they are today. So the short answer is that ranges tend to track the prevailing conditions during periods of climatic fluctuations. One of the limitations to that is time, right? There's dispersal time, there's the time scale at which such climate change unfolds. And unfortunately, one of the most pernicious features of contemporary climate change is simply the rate at which it's unfolding. All else being equal, you know, evolution requires time and organisms just aren't getting that time. We're making changes in the environment that are much, much faster than have historically happened. And I think that's one of the real sources of the challenge. That being said, I actually just finished up a paper on the effects of climate change on these Hispaniolan anoles. And part of it is actually a somewhat heartening story. with some asterisks. So the good news is that these high elevation lizards are actually really, really warm adapted for the cold environments that they occupy. So from a physiological perspective, and we've done the modeling on this, if anything, they should be expected to gain potential hours of activity as their environment becomes less cold stressful. That assumes, of course, it doesn't mean that their realized activity will go up, because in order to do that, you need to be able to fuel the metabolic demand, which requires the presence of sufficient prey, for example. So if they're, you know, if the insects aren't changing in number, if the insects are declining, then all of the potential hours in the world of activity wouldn't translate into realized hours. But that being said, I don't think that climate change is going to thermally constrict their activity, although that is true for many, many tropical lizards. I think these are the exception to the rule, because they are these surprisingly warm adapted lizards occupying really cold environments. That being said, I think their risks lie in other dimensions. We modeled what's basically they're only found in those monodominant pine forests, right? That's their macro habitat of choice. And their close relatives basically start kicking in presence, or the habitat transitions from, you know, monodominant pine forest at higher elevations to more broadleaf forest, i.e. cloud forest at lower elevation. I worked with some botanists, and what we discovered is we have a projected increase in the elevation of the cloud forest reflecting the changing climate, even though the risks may not lie in reduced hours of activity, it may seem maybe on physiological or behavioral grounds, these organisms may even be somewhat behaviorally resilient, but they may nonetheless be vulnerable along, for example, other aspects, other dimensions, for example, through habitat loss, because they really are only found in those high elevation monodominant pine forests. And if you lose the habitat, you lose the species. So climate change risk is a medusa. So it's a many-headed organism. And even if you're sort of successful or resilient in one dimension, there's probably another that poses, you know, a risk of vulnerability.
What is the lifetime of these lizards?
Well, they reach sexual immaturity within a couple of months to a year, depending on the species, and they can live a few years in the wild. It's uncommon to get really old in owls, but yeah, a couple of years typically.
And who's preying on them?
Everything. They're nature's lunchbox. They're highly edible. Yeah. If you can catch it, you can eat it. They have no toxins. They, you know, they bite, but if you can deal with that, I mean, their primary predators are birds and snakes, and, you know, mammals, most of which are introduced, unfortunately, but yeah, cats will eat them, feral cats. I've seen even chickens try to eat anoles. Yeah, but birds, avian predators.
Isn't that interesting that they don't, you said they don't have any toxins or anything. So what is their, speaking of evolution, what is their protection?
Well, ancestrally, these organisms were from the Latin American mainland. And there, they certainly live in extremely saturated predator communities, not just birds and snakes, but all kinds of other organisms, including primates, which love to eat anoles. And their tactic there is crypsis. They're really, really hard to detect. They spend most of their time clinging to vegetation, being extremely still and doing nothing much at all. And that's reflective of the stronger predation environment that they occupy. Relatively speaking, they've actually been somewhat released from that in the Caribbean, because those islands have been to a greater extent scrubbed of predators and competitors. And so predation risk is actually overall lower in the Caribbean. And relatively speaking, they spend a lot more proportionate time displaying and moving around their habitats. Nonetheless, you know, they still are relatively cryptic, you know, in a general sense, although with many, many exceptions. And they have these very conspicuous ornaments, those super colorful dewlaps that make them very, very visible to predators, but they can tuck it away when they're not using it. So they only use those dewlaps when they have to say something, right? Get off my perch. I'm still alive. You don't get to have my habitat. Or I'd like to court you, or something like that. And then they tuck their very conspicuous ornament away.
It's very fascinating.
It's a very fun system.
Yeah. if we have no more questions for Professor Muñoz, Steve, do you have another question?
No, just your hand is still
up. Oh, no. I forgot to withdraw.
That's okay.
That's quite all right.
I'll probably have another question next week. But
yeah, well, we will.
When I think about it.
So thank you very much, Professor Muñoz, for spending time with us this afternoon. It was really fascinating. Our next event will be...